Keratoconus is a degenerative corneal disease that results in blurred vision and often requires scleral contact lenses to correct vision or even a corneal transplant in advanced cases. In today's video, I'll cover all the treatments for this disease. Welcome back to iSchool with me, Dr. D, where I teach you about products and treatments related to dry eye syndrome and eye beauty so you can have healthy, beautiful, comfortable eyes. Give a little love tap on that subscribe button to stay up to date with all the latest eye tips and tricks I have for you. In today's video, I'm talking about keratoconus treatment options, and the first of which we have to talk about are traditional glasses and contact lenses. Now, traditional spectacle prescriptions and soft contact lenses will only work in the treatment of keratoconus, typically very early in the disease process. Because keratoconus causes irregular astigmatism and traditional glasses and soft contact lenses are meant to correct only regular astigmatism, these are just not the best treatment options for keratoconus. Many of my patients with keratoconus do have backup glasses that they can use in a pinch, but generally their best corrected vision in these glasses is much less than it is in their hard contact lenses. Which gets us into the second treatment for keratoconus, which are hard or scleral contact lenses. So in keratoconus, the irregular shape of the cornea or the cone that occurs degrades image quality, so vision correction is needed in most keratoconus patients. This is particularly challenging in keratoconus because it often requires a very tailored, individualized approach to each patient. In early keratoconus, you might be able to wear glasses or soft lenses, but as the disease progresses, the cornea protrudes more and more, and glasses and soft contact lenses just don't cut it anymore. Hard lenses are much more effective because their rigid structure allows them to vault that irregular cornea, trapping tears underneath and creating a new regular refracting surface. So let's talk about some of the ways you can use hard lenses. The first is what's called a piggyback lens. So piggybacking lenses refers to the practice of using a soft bandage contact lens first with the hard lens sitting over top. This is perfect for patients who cannot tolerate an RGP or hard lens alone. The second type of lens is a hybrid lens. So hybrid lenses emerged as an option for patients who weren't tolerating the traditional smaller diameter hard lenses. Hybrid lenses are an RGP or hard lens in the middle with a soft lens skirt around the outside of the lens. The most popular type of hybrid lens is called synergize. If you wear synergize lenses, make sure to let me know down below. Tell me how that wearing experience has been for you. Next, we have traditional RGP lenses. So traditional RGPs or hard lenses are, RGP stands for rigid gas permeable. We tend to call them hard lenses. The original hard lenses were PMMA way back in the day. So if you wore hard lenses that weren't very breathable and caused corneal swelling and things like that, that was probably a PMMA lens. Hard lenses now are made out of they're rigid gas permeable. So they are gas permeable, they allow breathability, and your cornea is much, much healthier in traditional RGPs now. And they're still a really great treatment choice for keratoconus. Your doctor can customize the lens to your eye. They can go with a wider diameter, smaller diameter, just to get it to fit over that cone and give you the best refracting surface possible to eliminate the double, triple, quadruple vision that sometimes happens looking through the irregular astigmatism of an eye with keratoconus. You can even move into a mini scleral design before you go to a scleral design contact lens. Like I said before, fitting these lenses is really individualized and it can be a challenge from patient to patient, but that's what makes it really fun is when you find the lens that works for your patient, the vision that they get out of them is so much better than they can get in their soft lenses or glasses. So let's talk a little bit about sclerals because sclerals have really come to popularity in the last 5 to 10 years. In extremely protruding cones, fitting a hard contact lens may become difficult, and patients can benefit from larger diameter lenses that lie on the white part of the eye, or the sclera, and vault over top of that cornea without ever touching its surface. Such contact lenses are referred to as sclerals, and in general, these lenses are very comfortable to wear and provide excellent vision in patients with keratoconus. There's also a subtype of scleral lenses called PROSE, or prosthetic replacement of the ocular surface ecosystem lenses. These prosthetics may be especially useful in extreme cases of keratoconus and are generally reserved as a last resort before a corneal transplant is considered. Hey, if you're still here and not asleep, please consider hitting the thumbs up so YouTube knows that I'm making quality content. That's right down below. All right, so moving away from the vision correction options of lenses and glasses and hard lenses and sclerals, let's talk a little bit more about other treatments. So I'm gonna get into corneal crosslinking. Corneal crosslinking is a little bit newer in the United States, but it's been performed successfully around the world for at least the past decade. It's a minimally invasive advanced therapy that slows down or stops the progression of the corneal deformation of keratoconus by making your collagen bonds in the cornea stronger. This allows the cornea to be very stiff and stop bulging out. Corneal crosslinking is an in-office procedure that involves three steps. It's done by an ophthalmologist, and first you'll have your cornea numbed with eye drops. Then they'll gently debride or remove the outer layer of your cornea, and they'll put special vitamin drops, which are riboflavin, on your eye many times over the course of 30 minutes or more. And finally, the third step is to shine a special ultraviolet light on your eye for another 30 minutes and keep adding those riboflavin drops. The vitamin drops and ultraviolet light work together to make those collagen bonds in the cornea stronger, allowing it to get stiffer and stop bulging out. Next, we have intracorneal transplants. These go by the name, I always refer to them as intacs, and I think that's just because intacs is the name of corneal ring segments that I've seen in my patients. But intracorneal ring segments are plastic, they're shaped like a C, and they're inserted within the cornea in order to flatten that surface, allowing it to refract light better. So keratoconus causes a bulging or cone that makes the cornea steeper. And so by inserting these intact rings, you're trying to flatten that cone back down and make the refraction a little more normal, a little more regular. The procedure is also done in office and it takes about 15 minutes. During the procedure, small tunnels are formed between layers in the stroma, which is the middle of your cornea, and the implants can be placed inside those tunnels. Intracorneal ring segments do not always correct vision fully. I've seen many cases in which contact lenses were still needed to correct vision. In addition, implants do not hold the progression of the disease. So while it's an effective treatment option, it is not a cure. Cornea transplant. So cornea transplant for keratoconus is usually saved for the advanced stages of the disease. Once we've tried cross-linking, soft and hard lenses, and we no longer can improve your visual acuity, it may be time for a corneal transplant. Corneal transplants happen on an outpatient basis. The surgery usually takes about an hour to complete in a cornea transplant. In a cornea transplant, the cornea of the patient is carefully removed and a donor cornea is sewn into place using stitches. The donor corneas are received from recently deceased persons with the permission of their next of kin. After a corneal transplant, vision can be very blurry and you must take medication ongoing. So you'll be on a steroid to avoid rejection of the cornea, as with any transplanted tissue within your body. After cornea transplant, glasses or even hard contact lenses are necessary to provide your best, clearest vision, even after the surgery. So a corneal transplant does not necessarily mean that your journey with keratoconus is over and you'll never have to wear soft or hard lenses again or glasses. Most likely you still will have to wear some type of vision correction. I hope that helped to understand the various treatment options for keratoconus. I'll make sure to leave chapter marks so you guys can check out the different areas. And if you've made it this far and you're not already subscribed to my channel, why not hit that button in the bell so that you don't miss notifications? That is going to be it for today's iSchool. Class is dismissed. Welcome back to iSchool with me. I just burped.